Microlecture 30, The Prelude to the Great War. After the era of industrialization, many things change in Europe. Social, political, economic and cultural changes transform the continent and most of its inhabitants' lives. New ideologies emerge and the nation-state appear as a viable political entity that shaped European politics in the decades before the Great War. After defeating Napoleon, the aristocratic monarchies of Russia, Prussia, Austria, and Great Britain, known as the Quadruple Alliance, reaffirmed their desire to hold France in line and defeat any attempt of war and revolution. At the Congress of Vienna in 1814-1815, a peace agreement was signed, assuring 50 years without major warfare in Europe. Although successful on the diplomatic front, after the Vienna Peace, the great powers refused to adopt social reforms to improve the lives of working people who were facing a new socio-economic reality associated with the Industrial Revolution. In 1815, under the leadership of Austrian Prince Clemens von Metternich, Austria, Prussia, and Russia formed the Holy Alliance, which aimed to stop the spread of liberal and secular ideas in Europe. The alliance issued decrees to root out revolutionary ideas in universities and newspapers, and committees were established to investigate and punish any liberal or radical organizations. Metternich was a conservative who believed that strong governments were needed to protect society from its warped instincts. Most conservatives at the time thought that liberalism, like the one practiced in France and the Americas, had been responsible for a generation of war and suffering. One of the most important things that happened in Europe after 1815 was the emergence of nationalism, an idea destined to have an enormous influence in the modern world. At the time, the idea argued that people from a determined ethnic group had their own spirit and cultural unity, manifest in a common language, history, and territory. In reality, that type of cultural unity was more a dream since there was plenty of diversity and difference in European territories. European nationalists sought to make the territory of each people coincide with well-defined boundaries in an independent nation-state. It was this political goal that made nationalism so explosive. In Europe, there were territories with few states, Austria, Russia, and the Ottoman Empire, or too many, the Italian Peninsula and the German Confederation. Another important ideology that emerged in Europe after 1815 was socialism. Many people were unhappy with the French Revolution's outcome, the policies of free trade, and the emergence of modern industry. Thus, they believed there was an urgent need to reorganize society and establish cooperation and a new community sense. Socialists had an intense desire to help the poor, whose living conditions were terrible, and they preached greater economic equality between rich and poor. Socialists also believed that government should regulate private property and, in some cases, abolish it and replace it with state or community ownership. Among the crucial things that need to be understood as an antecedent of the Great War in Europe were Italy and Germany's unification. Italy had never been a united nation before 1850. Since 1494, Italy was a battleground for great powers, and only in 1815 at Vienna's Congress, the territory was reorganized. Austria received the rich northern provinces of Lombardy and Venetia. Sardinia and Piemont fell under an Italian monarch rule, and Tuscany shared north-central Italy with several smaller states. The papacy ruled over central Italy and Rome, while the Bourbons ruled Naples and Sicily. The goal of having a unified Italian nation captivated the imagination of many Italians, but there was no agreement on how to do it. In 1848, people from the region of Sardinia began to mobilize in order to expel the Austrians and unify the northern and central parts of the country. The work done by the people in Sardinia was not enough for super patriots like Giuseppe Garibaldi, 1807-1882. A poor sailor's son, Garibaldi embodied romantic revolutionary nationalism. He led several victories against the Austrian troops and, in 1860, emerged as an independent force in Italian politics. Supported by famous Count Camillo Benso di Cavour, Garibaldi's guerrilla army conquered Italy's southern part with great support from the peasantry. His conquering of Naples symbolically sealed the union of North and South. Garibaldi and Victor Emmanuel formed a new kingdom that did not include Venice until 1866 or Rome until 1870. The kingdom was a parliamentary monarchy that was not radical nor democratic. Since that moment, a vast social and cultural divide emerged between the industrialized North and the rural South. Germany's unification happened after 1848 when the German states, Austria and Prussia, began to confront each other. Powerful economic force wanted to change the political status quo. Modern industry was growing greatly in the German part of the German states, and Austria was being excluded from the Solvereign, as the German custom union was known. One important factor that gave impetus to Germany's unification was the growth of the country's industrial middle class after 1850. This group of people had liberal ideals and tried to promote national unity. Born into the Prussian land-owning aristocracy, Count Otto von Bismarck, 1815-1898, was a pragmatic politician that loved power and had good relations with Prussia's King Wilhelm I. In 1862, the king drafted Bismarck to confront the parliament that wanted to establish liberal reform. Bismarck took office as chief minister in 1862 and declared that the government was going to rule without parliamentary consent. Bismarck also controlled Prussia's bureaucracy and collected taxes, although the majority of the people backed up the liberals. In 1866, Bismarck launched the Austro-Prussian War with the intent of expelling Austria from German politics. The war lasted only 7 weeks. Bismarck forced Austria to withdraw from German affairs and dissolve the German Confederation. After the Austrians' expulsion, the mainly Protestant states north of the Main River were grouped in the new North German Confederation, led by an expanded Prussia. Each state retained its local government, but the federal government controlled by Wilhelm and Bismarck dominated the army and foreign affairs. Bismarck made peace with the liberal factions who jumped at the chance to cooperate, opting for national unity and military glory over the battle for truly liberal institutions. The final act of the German unification was a patriotic war against France in 1870. After Germany's quick victory, the southern state decided to join the new German Empire. The Franco-Prussian War released an enormous surge of patriotic feeling in Germany. The new German Empire had become Europe's most powerful state, and most Germans were enormously proud. Authoritarianism, nationalism, and conservatism supported by the middle and working classes had triumphed in Germany. This is all I have for you today. Thank you, and I'll see you next time.